Session number 16. It's a special edition, it's the Festivas edition. So, Sir Deacon Gilles will give us some extra insight into what he's learned. Something that I would ask of you is that we're all on different journeys, different paths, and we all get something different out of these classes. Some people say, okay, I've already heard this, I already know that. Other people says, hey, we didn't cover this, and this. So if there are topics you want to discuss, please let me know. Just put in the question book. It's not that we're going to talk about it tonight, but I'd like to get an idea of what topics that I'm missing. So you might say, hey, it'd be great if we talked about this, and this. I don't know if it'll happen in the next 2-3 months, but I'd like to definitely get ready for our fall edition. Because Deacon Gilles says he'd love to come back next year.
Really?
Wow. So, I want to get ready for some of those classes. So, if there's something that you want to discuss we haven't, then I'd love to know that. So, having said that, Jacques, you're missing a great class again today. Are you ready to go?
Oui.
Okay.
Hey-ho.
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 Where is everybody?
Well, we bring Festival to you. I am, if you're looking on camera there, you can see, for the first time in my life, and I am ethnically French-Canadian, so go figure, you know, but for the first time in my life, I'm looking like a voyageur. Now, if you're in Florida or California watching this, I doubt it, but if you are, this is a Franco-Manitoban thing. Franco meaning French, Manitoban. This culture, although I'm really a Franco-Ontarian, but that's okay. This is a French-Canadian thing, so here we go. This is called a ceinture fléchée. I don't know why, but it means an arrow belt, whatever that means. And this is a shirt from the 1700s with poofy sleeves. There.
Makes you
but I'm fun. Still me, and I'm still going to teach tonight, even with my puffy sleeves. So we're going to continue again on the Mass. So let's begin with a prayer. Let's begin with the prayer that we hear during Mass. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. My friends, we dare to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So again, we're going to continue, and again, I'm going to go as far as I can with the Mass. But if we pause and savor certain parts of the Mass, and that's as far as we go, fine by me, as long as you're learning. But otherwise, we'll keep rolling through. Good. Any questions arising from last week's class right now? Any thoughts of last week's presentation that I can begin with? No. Do you remember how far I went? So if I started from the beginning, would you even remember? No, you wouldn't.
You weren't here.
You
got as far as the offertory.
Okay, I got as far as the offertory. Okay, so first, so I'm going to review again. So we had the gospel, of course, and what do we do differently during the gospel than we do the before the gospel? We stand.
Yes.
That's right. And why do we stand during the gospel?
A sign of reverence.
Yeah, but the whole word of God is reverent, isn't
that's
it?
True.
So why do we stand at the gospel? What's so special about the gospel?
Because we're talking to God.
We're talking to God.
Yeah. Or God is talking to us.
Well, isn't God talking in the Old Testament?
No.
In a way, yes. But what's special about the gospel?
Well,
Jesus, right? It's about Jesus. That's the answer. Whenever you're stuck in catechism class, the answer, the best answer you can always give is Jesus. Unless you know it's Mary. then otherwise it's Jesus. Well, God is Jesus. And Jesus is God. But are you talking about God the Father, God the Son, or God the Holy Spirit? But specifically, the Gospels are about the second person of the Trinity, Jesus himself. And so we stand out of reverence for the words of Christ, and out of the reverence for it is Jesus who comes to us, especially as Christians, we honor the words of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Then after the Gospel, we have a homily. Anyone know the difference between a homily and a sermon?
The homily ties in the readings.
Right. And a sermon?
Teaching.
It's preaching.
Preaching.
They're both preaching.
It's a teaching.
But a sermon is?
Personal. A teaching.
That's right. So if, let's say, the priest said, okay, for the next 7 weeks, I'm going to talk about the Ten Commandments, right? And just not worry about what readings they are that Sunday. I'm just going to go right through the Ten Commandments. The preaching he would do on the Ten Commandments, that's a sermon. Now, it's not recommended that we do sermons on Sunday. Homily. It's meant to be a reflection on the readings that are given. You can preach on part of what the text of the Mass is, but most importantly, the homily is meant to be based on the readings. Sometimes there are priests who will preach about a particular topic or whatever, right? But it won't have anything to do with the homily, or with the readings, rather. That's more of a sermon. Now, is it bad or evil? Are you going to write the Pope if he does a sermon instead of a homily? No. If it's good, don't write anybody anything. Just enjoy it, right? But if it's really, really way off topic and whatever and not faithful to the church, well, then write the bishop or something or whatever. Or write him. But yeah, homily is meant to be a reflection on the readings of the day. Hopefully, if you go to church enough, the readings are cyclical enough, eventually you should be able to cover most things that we believe as Catholics, because the readings will cover a variety of topics when you go through the three-year cycles, right? So you should be able to preach. But if I'm going to give, you know, a pro-life sermon every single Sunday, well, then I'm not really paying attention to the readings. But surely to goodness, there are times when I can bring it in. Because as a Catholic, I should be able to present what we believe in the right time and place. At least that's how I prefer to be thematic with the readings, and to go with that, because that's why we have the readings, to reflect on that. Sometimes there's an important issue, like a couple months ago, the bishop asked all of us on one particular Sunday to preach about assisted suicide, because that had to be, it was relevant to the election, it was relevant to what's going on in society, and sometimes the bishops of a country or of a diocese or whatever will ask their priest to preach a specific thing because of an urgent issue going on in the country or the area or whatever. That can happen. But generally the homily is meant to take God's word that you read that Sunday to today. Make sense? And that's the difference. A sermon is more of a teaching, especially if there's a series of sermons. Most of us in ordinary day conversation will use the words completely interchangeable. After Mass, people always shake my hand and say, that was a very good sermon. I'm not going to get into a five-minute discussion over the difference in semantics over that. I just say, thank you. If it wasn't me preaching, then I'll say, well, meh. You know, no. It wasn't me, it was the other guy. Now, what comes next after the homily?
And we have the creed.
We have the creed. What is the creed? Where did creed come from?
Credo.
Credo, which is Latin, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
Believe. Believe.
Means I believe, right?
I believe.
Okay, so the creed comes from credo. It's I believe. It's what we believe in common. In the old Mass, the Tridentine Liturgy, you remember the two parts of the Mass? What are the two major sections of the Mass?
Liturgy of the Word.
Liturgy of the Word, and then?
Liturgy of the Eucharist.
Liturgy of the Eucharist. Okay? In the old Mass, like I have an old missal that belonged to my dad that he got as a prize in 1957 for being like altar boy of the year. And in the beginning of the missal, what we call now the Liturgy of the Word, they called the Mass of Catechumens. Mass of Catechumens. In the early church, if you were a catechumen, you know what a catechumen is?
One who's studying the faith. Or becoming.
Specifically who? Are any of you catechumens here?
No.
Why?
Because we've been baptized.
You've been baptized. So a catechumen is someone who is not baptized, who is preparing for baptism, right? So in the early church, if you were a catechumen, you could attend the Liturgy of the Word. And that's why they call that part of the Mass, in the old liturgy, the Mass of Catechumens. Because before the Creed, they would be dismissed and they would have to go. Some parishes now, like we'll do at Holy Cross during Lent, is the people will stay during the Liturgy of the Word, and then the candidates will be dismissed, and then we will go to another room and we will share on the Gospels. We'll kind of pass the kids, because the kids leave at the beginning and have the Liturgy of the Word by themselves, but they stay for the Eucharist, but the adults will leave because they can't receive the communion yet, and so we'll probably pass each other in the hallway, but or in the aisle. So the Liturgy of the Eucharist was at that time for those who stayed after the profession of faith, who professed the faith of the Church, who stayed. Originally, why it was secret, that you couldn't even attend, never mind the beginning of Mass, was of course because being a Christian was
forbidden.
It was illegal, right? It was punishable by death to be this religion because you weren't a good citizen of the Roman Empire. And so many, many of the emperors of Rome had outlawed Christianity and said, these people don't worship the gods of the Roman Empire, etc., etc., and so they were seen as traitors, treacherous, right? And so then they were put to death. And so you don't want someone who is really a spy, right, from the Roman government, to come into your mass and round all you up, or you all up, right? That's why you had sponsors. That sponsor would vouch for you and say, this person is really a convert. Right? That person will vouch for you. This person is really a convert. Same thing happened in AA from what I hear. Mm-hmm. In the early days of AA, there'd be reporters who'd want to know, oh, I wonder what judge is an alcoholic. So they try to sneak in, right? Nope, you can't get into the meeting unless you've been screened first. So that if you were a judge or a politician or whatever, your anonymity or your privacy was protected so that there were no snoopy people trying to find out, well, who's a recovering drunk. Although finding out that they're recovering isn't as much of a scandal as if you had found them, you know, at the bar, you know, 2 years before. I don't get it. Why recovery is such a bad thing and being, you know, anyway, but nonetheless, there was the taboo of finding out who was this, because of course they would know that they had this in their past. So the same thing for Christians, that you had to screen out any Roman spies who would try to round up Christian believers who go into Sunday Eucharist. That's where you would find them, and they would arrest the people and all that. But those who were preparing for baptism, they were already vouched for, so they could stay for the Liturgy of the Word, to receive, to hear the homily, to hear the preaching, but then they would be dismissed until their baptism at Easter. Then they could stay for the whole liturgy. That's why that part was called the Mass of Catechumens. Then the second part of Mass, again in the old liturgy, was called the Mass of the Faithful. Those who were Catholic stayed for the rest of the liturgy. So then after the profession of faith kind of becomes a pivot between the two sections. And then the next part is the prayers of the faithful, or the general intercessions. The general intercessions is a chance where we, all of us, including, because I'm not a priest, where we all get to exercise our baptismal priesthood. Because it is not the prayer of the clergy, it's the prayer of the faithful. So whose prayer is it? Your prayer. The best type of prayer of the faithful is when it's able to be done spontaneously from the congregation. On a Sunday Mass in a big church, that's impossible to do, and you have no idea what kind of strange things people might say or take an opportunity to maybe give a rebuttal to the sermon or something, right? So you need to kind of watch that. But who typically does the prayer of the faithful? A member of the faithful. Now, in the rubrics, it says the deacon can do that too, right? Because I'm not a priest, I'm a member of the faithful. So the deacon, it's given the deacon to do if he can or wants to or whatever. But it's also given to you to do, right? For the lay people. The laity offer the prayer of the faithful. Now, I would say that, and I learned this when I took that diocesan course, that I won't name on video, but you know what I mean, but I liked this part that they taught, was that ideally the prayer of the faithful should come from that local community. Not from a book made in Ottawa 6 months ago. No. How's that relevant to this parish in this time and this day? It should be the prayer that rises up from the hearts of that parish, ideally. There are general principles that it should take. We always pray for the Pope, we always pray for the Bishop, we always pray for the needs of the world. It has a structure to it, right? But it should come from someone in the parish, maybe writes them. Then you can include current events. Then you can include events relevant to the parish. You know, we pray for our candidates who are preparing for baptism. We pray for the people that are in our marriage prep, or we pray for whatever we're praying for. And remember, they're general intercessions. So naming specific people to be prayed for can be difficult because you might miss somebody, right? It's okay to pray for Madame whatever who died this week, right? But try and add, and for all who have died. Right, or for so and so who's in the hospital, but at least throw in everybody else who has a loved one in the hospital. But again, having some names can be nice, you know. The awkward, if you do too specific, you'll leave somebody in the parish out, which isn't meant to be, but it should be somehow relevant to the parish. At least even when it's in the book, most priests will say, they'll pause and at the very end they'll say, and we stop and pray for our own personal intentions. And that way we're all silently lifting up our grandma or our grandchildren or our nieces and nephews or somebody who's sick or somebody who's going through a hard time or someone whose marriage is having a difficulty or has fallen apart or whatever, or for the new grandbaby. Any new ones lately? No, but there might be more coming. And so all of those ups and downs that we're giving to God, right, we praise the Lord for that and all that. So at least we're included in that sense, where we pray silently in our heart. But some of that could be written by the parish, where someone in the parish is responsible for preparing the prayers of the faithful for the community for that Sunday. That would be beautiful. Rather than someone, 1,000 miles away, writing just, intentions for the whole country. It's nice, it's helpful, but they should be used as guidelines, not as, but we're lazy and we don't want to write our own, so we use the ones in the book. Not that I'm not saying it's evil or bad, but it would be nice if at least one or two intentions could reflect something from this from the local parish. so that you feel like you're praying for something that you all have in common. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So the prayer of the faithful is our priestly. Remember when we were baptized, we were anointed priest, prophet, and king. And so the prayers of the faithful is when we do our prayer up to the Father, we offer as baptized people our prayer to the Lord. After the prayer of the faithful comes the priest's favorite part of the Mass. What part is that?
Collection.
The collection. That's right. That's the priest's favorite part of the Mass. So the collection happens, or we call it the preparation of the gifts, right? So you prepare the gifts. What are the gifts?
Wine.
Wine.
Water.
And?
Bread.
The bread.
Bread.
What else?
The money.
The collection, right?
The cash.
Yeah. Now the money, on a practical level, is there to help keep the building, you know, running. To keep the lights on, to pay salary of the secretary and whoever else, the janitor or the caretaker of the building, and all the different, you know, ministries and works in the parish, and help the poor and whatever. Okay, that on a practical level. But it also, the money represents ourselves, right? Money is an abstraction. Money isn't a real thing, is it? It represents a certain number of hours of work. It represents something that we use as a way of exchanging things and that. It's not a real thing. But it represents something. When we put money into the collection, it represents a bit of our work, right? And we give our something of ourselves. And so we should give something that's meaningful to the church. We should give something that's doesn't impoverish us, because I don't think the Lord expects that. But it should be something that is worthy of giving to the church. I remember, what year would that have been? Maybe it was in the 90s. I went to visit my grandma in Ontario. And she had $2 she put in her envelope. I think she was giving $2 since the 60s. It wasn't possible for me to tell my grandma that with inflation, the $2 doesn't stretch as far as it did in 1969, you know? And so we should be as generous as we can without, again, losing our, you know, livelihood or causing harm to our families. Obviously, that would be irresponsible. Where that mark is, obviously, the Old Testament tells it 10%, and then again, people debate whether it's gross or net, you know, and all that stuff, you know, but give what you can. I was in a parish that their standard was give 1 hour's wage per week to the church. But I thought, that's nice. It's probably less than 10%, right? But it's at least something that if everybody averaged that, they felt that would pay all the bills for the parish. 1 hour. So if you make $25 an hour or $12 an hour, that's what you gave. That was what they recommended. If some people feel that the Lord is calling them to give 10%, then you figure out whether it's gross or net. Because I know what you pay in taxes is pretty gross, so all you have left is the net. So you got to give to Caesar what's Caesar's, and give to God whatever Caesar will let you give to God. So, yeah, but be responsible with that. I know Roland wants me to give a whole class on that, but maybe at some point in the future I can talk a little bit more about giving and that. Although that class would be more in my own opinion and not necessarily a doctrine of the Catholic Church. There's no specific doctrine of that. But again, we should be generous people. We should be a giving people. We should bless the church as much as we can. If we can't give, and our little widow's mite is all we can give, that's fine. But we can give also in many other ways too, of our time, of our abilities, and all of that. So there's giving in many, many ways, especially for those who are not well off. They can give the equivalent of $25 an hour by helping the parish office or something like that, right? You have a question?
No, I'm just going to make a little commentary. about, you know, older people. My mother-in-law was chastised by her sister-in-law. Sister-in-law, that she was not contributing to the church because she didn't put an envelope in the basket every Sunday. Uh-huh. And it was a disgrace. And with the electronic giving now and all that, I wonder how many people still think that. You know, that if you don't put an envelope into the collection basket every Sunday, that you're not supporting the church.
Well, I do it electronically.
Oh, I know. Yeah. But you can't put that in the basket.
No, I know.
Yeah.
But that's not the point is I give electronically.
Yeah.
Did she give electronically and got hacked for it anyway?
Yeah, she'd give once a month, but write a big check.
Well, that's fine. Same difference.
I know, but I mean, people make those assumptions, eh?
Well, put in an empty envelope. Put in your empty envelope and say, try and embezzle that, you know? Yeah. But no, well, obviously. And eventually over time, we might all, you know, in 50 years from now, maybe no one will know what a check is.
Yeah.
It'll all be electronic. But the collection is still a time for us to give of ourselves. So even if the money isn't done the same way, there is always other things. We bring up the bread and wine, right? We don't have to bring up the money. That's not essential. And in fact, there are many places like, I don't know, I was at Mass in the Vatican. They didn't pass a hat there. You know, so lots of Masses happen. Weekday Masses we don't have. Mm-hmm. There is a strange custom here. If you're American and you're watching this, I'll tell you this weird custom they do avec les French Canadians. They have collection during a funeral.
Yeah.
That's bizarre. English parishes don't do that.
But they do that here once in a while. I've seen it.
Yeah, yeah. Well, because of the French that are here. It's a French-Canadian custom. It's
but
not an English-Canadian custom.
The priest asks.
Yeah.
The priest asks.
Yeah. Yeah. But English priests don't do that. Some English priests never even heard of that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
I know a little more.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
There's French people.
Yeah. Yeah.
You want more prayers?
So, yeah. Just so you know, it's for Masses to be said. So priests don't mind that.
No.
Although church law is the money they get from Masses has to be donated. They don't keep it for themselves. They can't buy a car with it or anything like that.
Getting back to your poor grandma, $2 in 1969 was probably a lot. She probably overpaid back then.
Fine, defend my grandma. See you. I still think she should have, you know, accounted for inflation. Although that reminds me, it's been a few years since I bumped up my own collection, so maybe I should contact the parish and put, you know, $2,010 into $2,016, you know. So yeah, we got to do that. Next comes, okay, so we have the preparation of the gifts. So the gifts are brought up, right, to the altar. Sometimes they're not, they're already at the altar or on the side table, but we should bring up the gifts. Another tradition that I see as a store owner is that there are a couple parishes where people will come and they will literally buy the wine and hosts for the Mass. The parishioner will buy it and they will give it. They'll bring it up. So I thought that was kind of a nice tradition, as much as it sounds like a cheap point on the side of the parish to make the parishioners directly buy it, but from the point of view of it being them bringing it and giving it as their offering, you know, hopefully they get a receipt for it. That would be nice, you know. But you had a question.
I thought there was the wine for Mass had to be specifically done in a certain way.
Well, they buy it from me. It's sacramental wine.
Well, you say,
yeah. No, no.
Being a store owner.
Okay.
Yeah. So I sell sacramental wine.
Double distilled.
Yeah. So it has to be. It's sacramental wine they buy, and they buy hosts from me, right? There's a couple parishes in Winnipeg Diocese that do that. One specifically that I know fairly well, but it was a couple people from another parish that came the other day, and they bought. And that was there. It tends to be Filipinos, and I think maybe in the Philippines they have that tradition that the people actually go get the wine and everybody takes a turn to bring the wine and the hosts up that they get, you know, and that. So there's something nice about being part of the Mass, and that's my offering to the Mass, you know. So then we have the prayer, once the gifts are at the altar, the priest goes, "Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this bread to offer. And blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to offer." This "blessed are you" prayer goes back to the Passover. It's called a barakah. It means a blessing. Okay. Whatever your politics are, the President of the United States, his name is Barak. Okay, that's related to the Hebrew word barakah, blessing. So it's the blessing from Hebrew, barakah, or baruch, baruch atai Adonai, blessed are you, Lord God. And so we pray the blessing prayer, and that again goes back to the Passover, when Jesus prayed the blessing. So that's the most Jewishy part of the Catholic Mass, is the blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have this bread to offer. Now, I don't know how many of you have been to a Mass with a deacon, but you notice that the deacon can, and does, if I do it, takes the wine, and the deacon puts the wine in the chalice, and the deacon puts the water in the chalice, and the deacon says, you know what he says? You know what the priest says when he does it, if there's no deacon? By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. You don't know that?
They all go like this.
Oh, do they whisper it?
Yeah, they whisper. Yeah. Their mics are off.
Ah. Not even in French, they don't say it out loud. I don't know what they say in French. By the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. You didn't know what was said. So what's the meaning behind the little bloop of water? You've seen that, right? Where the priest puts the water in the wine.
Just a drop.
Yeah, just a drop.
Baptismal.
What does it mean? What do you think it means?
It doesn't mean that we become one with Christ.
We become one with Christ?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other thoughts?
The wine is too strong.
Well, you know what? It does have a history. Because in the Middle Ages, or in ancient times, maybe even back to the time of Jesus, the wine was very strong, and you would put half and half, right? So there are a few things that we do at Mass that actually have an old custom that was very practical, and this is one of them, that you always mixed water and wine. Now, a couple years ago, I was helping out as a deacon at a Ukrainian Catholic liturgy in Brandon. I'd gone with another deacon friend of mine who's Ukrainian Catholic deacon, and I helped out even though I didn't know at all what I was doing, because I don't know their liturgy very well, so I was a bit lost. But I got to see what happened behind the iconostasis, because it's kind of, you know, top secret location, right? But I'm ordained, so I can go, right? Well, this particular parish, and again, I haven't been to many of them, so I don't know what they all do, but this particular liturgy, they added hot water to the wine, because blood is warm, they told me. I'm like, who knew? I don't often drink real blood, you know, I just drink sacramental blood, right?
Yeah,
so that's pretty cool.
But the French are frogs.
Yeah. Yeah, but Jesus wasn't a frog, even though I am dressed like a frog. He's making me wear the Saint Sulpice. So yeah, they mix hot water because, again, blood is warm. I thought, oh, that's kind of interesting. So that, I don't know if every Ukrainian church does that, but the very serious ones, they use hot water. So the water and wine, again, part of it was you had to mix water with wine because the wine was too thick. So you had to mix it. But now there's a spiritual symbolism, at least for us, with the drop. The drop is me, is you,
humanity.
Each of us, but each person, right? And we're being dropped into the Lord. So afterwards, right, that drop of water is surrounded by the Lord, where I'm totally immersed in the Lord. You know, you heard of French immersion? Well, this is God immersion. This is Jesus immersion. I'm fully immersed in the Lord. I'm fully surrounded in Him, right? French immersion teaches you how to think in French and do math in French, They even do English and French, right? And everything is in French so that you are immersed and plunged, right? And in a way, you're right. It reminds us of our baptism when we are immersed in the Lord, right? But that water is me, and I'm taking a dive into, by the mystery of this water, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ as he humbled himself to share in our humanity, right? By the mystery of this water, by the mingling of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ who humbled himself to share in our humanity. The Orthodox Church calls becoming a saint divinization, which isn't the same thing as, let's say a Hindu idea or whatever, that we become God, literally, but that we become holy like God. But they use the term divinization. We're called to be made holy. We're called to become more like Christ. We're called to become divinized in that sense. That's the holiness that we're called to be. And so that I plunge into Christ and may I become holy just as Jesus became human. God came down and experienced this earthly fleshliness, or this fleshly earthliness, right? And he wants to transform me so that I may share in his divine life. And that's what we're exchanging at the Mass, right? I'm exchanging my poverty for his riches. I'm changing my sin for his grace. I'm exchanging my lowliness for his greatness. It's a swap. It's not a fair swap. Not a fair at all. Like God gets the junk, he gets the garbage, and we get gold and silver in a way, spiritually. Right? It's like, this is a mystery. It really is. That's what Jesus did on the cross, right? He exchanged our sin for holiness. And Mass is boring. Imagine that. So we're plunged into God. So, and then also during that little ceremony, the priest washes his hands. Again, that has a very old practical purpose. Do you know what that is? Some of you might have learned this too.
He was just cleaning his hands to wash.
Well, okay, there's a practical side, yes. But what does he say? Lord, wash away my iniquity, cleanse me from my sins. But again, think in the Middle Ages. How much cash did people have?
Filthy lucre. Oh, sorry.
What?
I was thinking of money.
How much cash did they have? What did they have?
Animals.
So what did they give the priest?
A chicken.
Here's my chicken. You know? Yeah. It had a practical application. But it becomes spiritualized. I'm convinced, it's going on the record, keep this for 100 years and prove me wrong. I'm convinced. You know now how communion ministers will go and will sanitize their hands? 100 years from now, it'll be part of the Mass and we won't know why we do it anymore. Because we have all these other things in the Mass that it started out in a practical way. You know, like the water and wine, it becomes spiritualized. We totally forgot what the purpose of it was. Right? So we're going to use a hand sanitizer. So 100 years from now, people are going to go, you know, oh, this must have some... We'll make a spiritual meaning behind it. Well, Jesus sanitizes us from our sins.
But this would also not go back to the Judaic tradition of washing hands.
Oh, of course. Because the purification and all that. Right. Of course, there's always the spiritual washing, as baptism means and all that in the Old Testament too. They had the laver in the temple and all that, sure. But on a practical level, the priest was washing his hands because he didn't want to get feathers in the chalice, right? So there was a practical side to it, a little humor there. But, And so... Ruined my joke, you know. That was a perfectly good joke with the hand sanitizer. But one day it's going to be part of the Mass, and we won't remember why.
I always thought you put the drop of wine in there because God turned water into wine.
Well, that's another possibility. That's another possibility of turning water into wine. But when the words I actually say, okay, What I don't know is why the deacon gets to do it. I know I was taught, but I forgot. So I got to ask again somebody else. Deacon Ted knows. I know he knows. And I'll have to ask him again next time I see him. Because there are certain things the priest has to do. There's certain things a deacon can do. There's certain things a deacon can't do. And so why I can do that, I don't know why I can, but I can. So I do. Right? Okay, so he washes his hands. Lord, wash away my iniquity, cleanse me from my sins. As he's doing that, let's hope that we're saying the same thing. Right? Let's hope we're saying the same thing. He's doing a gesture on all our behalf. Lord, wash away our iniquity, cleanse us of our sins. Make us again ready to receive the Eucharist. The priest says, get this right, knowing me. Where'd you go? I know, the suspense is killing me too. Okay, the priest says, may the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy. No, that's what we say. Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Then we say, may the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church. What sacrifice are we talking about? May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands.
The changing into...
Not yet. No. That hasn't happened yet. What sacrifice?
The death of Christ.
Nope, not yet. What are we sacrificing?
Say that whole sentence again.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
The gifts?
That's right. So what am I sacrificing? What's on the altar right now?
Bread.
Bread and wine. And that's all it is, right? Bread, 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 wine, wine, wine. That's it. That is our sacrifice. So may the Lord accept this humble bread and this humble wine. May the Lord accept this offering. Remember what I said. No priesthood, no sacrifice. Are there Jewish priests today?
No.
Why?
The temple is burned.
Right, and that's the only place a Jew can make a sacrifice, is at the in the temple, right? If they ever somehow rebuilt the temple, maybe on a different location because there's a mosque on top of where the old location was. It's pretty close anyway.
Pretty close, yeah.
Not nice to do that on someone else's turf, you know, but anyway. But, you know, if they hypothetically rebuilt the temple, okay, and there were Jewish dudes doing sacrifices in the temple, what would you call those people?
Priests.
Priests, okay? So, a religion that has a sacrifice has a priest. So, another religion, they might sacrifice incense, they might sacrifice a goat, they might sacrifice the firstborn child. Not too many do human sacrifices anymore, thank goodness, but the Aztecs did. The sacrifice, the person that does the sacrificing is a priesthood. So, Catholicism, for us to have a priesthood, means sacrifice. Okay? In Protestantism, the communion service is not considered a sacrifice, therefore their clergy are not called priests because they don't have sacrifice. Now, Protestants believe that there is a priesthood of all believers, and that's like what we say about the baptismal priesthood. The sacrifice we offer is our very lives. They have that type of priesthood, but not a Eucharistic priesthood. It's not a sacrifice. Okay. Anglicanism is sort of half Catholic, half Protestant. So they sort of have Sometimes they go by priest, sometimes they go by minister. But to be really considered priesthood, they have to have a sense of there's a sacrifice happening there. And that's why you'll have very Catholic Anglicans and very Protestant Anglicans. The theology, even within there, would be different. Yes?
So, this may sound dumb, but seeing we're talking about the sacrifice of the Mass.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking of Christ's sacrifice on the cross.
Right.
It was pierced with blood and water came out. Is there any connectedness of that as to why also there's water in the sacrifice of the Mass? Why
could be.
Water is used?
Could be. I've never heard that, but I know that the early fathers always saw the blood and water flowing from the side of Christ.
Right.
The water was representing baptism, and the blood representing the Eucharist.
Oh.
I've heard that. You know, the fact that we mix water and wine could have some symbolism there too. I've never heard that, but you can think that way, sure. Or like when he turned water into wine. There's a lot of multi-images going on here, so there's a lot of symbolism there, sure. I don't think that's a bad thought to think, you know. So, the Mass is a sacrifice. We offer the sacrifice to the Lord. Just our humble bread and wine. Those simple things. Very fragile bread and very spillable wine. These very basic things, these very crumbly things. Right? We're not offering him gold. We're not offering him titanium. You know, we're offering him something very fragile. Very vulnerable things, you know, things you could crush, things you could step on, things you could spill, right? Very fragile. But wasn't that Jesus in the manger very fragile? Wasn't that Jesus in the cross very fragile? God is willing to be fragile for us in order that we could approach him. Doesn't come, you know, inaccessible to us. God comes very accessible. This is why God comes in the flesh and why he comes in the Eucharist, because he wants to be accessible. Then after, there's the prayer over the gifts, after we do all the blessed are you. The prayer over the gifts, again, is thematic to that Sunday. Ordinary time, there's like maybe five or six options for the priest. Easter season or Lent or Advent, there are a few options, but the prayer over the gifts is always matched to the theme. Okay? Then comes the preface dialogue. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. So this little dialogue goes back to the first century. Goes back to the first century. Christians did that at the Mass. It begins the great prayer of the Mass. The Lord be with you. We say it a few times during the Mass to let us know it's introducing an important part of the Mass. The Lord be with you. The Lord be with you. The Lord be with you with your spirit. Then the priest will say, lift up your hearts. In other words, be encouraged. Be consoled. Raise them up to the Lord. Give your hearts to the Lord. Lift them up. Be filled with joy. Because we're entering into our salvation. Then he says, let us give thanks. And we say, it is right,
right.
Just, or in French, cela est juste et bon. Notice how the translation matches better now. In ancient Greek, when we said, let us give thanks, what word did we use for give thanks?
Eucharist.
Let us Eucharist. Give thanks. What are we giving thanks for?
Dying on the cross.
That's not the most important thing you're giving thanks for. What are you doing in church? Right? The most important thing we have to give thanks for is our salvation. Of that Jesus redeemed us. We give thanks for the dying and the rising of Christ on the cross. We'll continue with this maybe after the break, if there's no questions. If there are questions, then we'll continue with this next week. But I want to, and I'll say it again next week. As I said, we offer the sacrifice of bread and wine. Right? We give to God bread and wine. You know what we get back? More literally, what do we get back from God?
His body, his blood.
Yeah. What a powerful exchange. It's like we say, God, here's bread and wine. And he goes, okay, here's Jesus. He gives it back to us as himself. The sacrifice that goes up is bread and wine. The sacrifice that comes down is the Paschal mystery, the dying and rising of Jesus. Amazing exchange. Mm-hmm. It's not a fair, the equation, the accounting is all lopsided. It's all in our favor. All in our favor. God gives it all to us. We give him nothing, you know, 50 cents worth of bread, you know, a dollar worth of wine, and he changes it into his body and blood. Is that a fair exchange? No? Amazing. That's the transformation. That's the sacrifice. We sacrifice the bread and wine, and then we receive the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. Break time.
Oh, thank you. You like that? I got an extra one for you next year.
Yes,
okay.
I have one.
I want some questions.
Well, most people don't. It's blank. I haven't worn it in 10 years. Actually, I'm getting into it now. I'm like, okay.
Oh, yeah.
So, I thought we'd dress him up. Give him something different.
So I hope this question's from the floor.
Yeah.
Right, from the people.
Where would it be from?
I don't know, the ceiling? The walls? Maybe the books on the walls?
Hallway.
So, first question. When writing prayer intentions, I was told that you should not say that. Example, for all our children, that they remain close to the Lord. Saying that is like giving God directions. Rewrite. For all our children who are struggling to remain close to the Lord, we pray to the Lord. Okay, I remember hearing someone say the same thing. Now, I don't know, I'm not, like, we can play semantic games, right? So I don't want to play semantic games that if you use the word that, you know, because you could maybe say the word that and not give directions to the Lord. Okay, never mind the exact words, but it's like, don't tell God how to answer the prayer.
Right.
You just give it to the Lord. Because to me, if you said, for all our children that they may remain close to the Lord, there's nothing wrong with that. Because you're not saying exactly how he's going to do it. And that would be the heart of everybody that's writing it, right? That you remain close to the Lord. Right? That. They may. Is that your question?
Yeah.
Because I saw you were putting it in the box, so I thought it was you.
There were two questions in the box.
What? Are they both from you?
I thought they were both from the same person. Sorry.
Oh, yeah, they're the same writing, but not both from the same
person. Oh, okay. That's fine. But yeah, I don't care about the semantics of that or this or whatever, right? But the principle makes sense to me, that you're not bossing God around. We shouldn't boss God around in prayer. You do it in your private prayer if you like. He knows you and whatever. But yeah, we don't boss God around. But to say, you know, I don't know, for our politicians, that they may have some sense knocked into them. Is that a bad prayer? No, but it's a little too direct, you know. Actually, I like that prayer, actually. That's the only one that's allowed. All right. But yeah, our prayers of the faithful shouldn't be bossy sounding. I think if you put it that way, that's simple enough. And we probably heard it from the same priest, I bet.
Probably.
Yeah. But that makes sense, though. I understand. I understand the directive to not boss God around when we do a prayer. It should be allow him to answer it in the way he wants, you know. Next question. Why don't we use red communion wine? We can.
Our churches use what?
The type of wine that's used is entirely at the discretion of the priest.
So long as it's grape-based, right?
As long as it's grape wine, a sacramental wine. And again, wines come in what? Three kinds. White, red, and rosé. Okay? So, now, here in Manitoba, at least according to the sales I have in my store, 99, Staffordshire Church, 337 William, 1-800-943-5779. I may as well make some money off of this.
Do you have a website?
Yes, stephanchu.ca. Thank you. Actually, the new one will be launched soon. So it'll look really good. Here in Manitoba, the pattern tends to be my Protestant customers, Anglicans and Lutherans, tend to buy red. Most of them, some don't. And my Catholic customers, almost all of them like white. And the preference is the white doesn't stain the cloths as much. Another guy I know who is a supplier or has a retail store in Ontario, but he also sells wholesale other things, in his store, and he's a Lutheran, he's in Kitchener, he told me that in Ontario it's the opposite. The Protestants have white and the Catholics have red. So it can be regional or whatever. I guess one priest tells another, oh, you know, white doesn't stain the purificators. Oh, okay, well, let's do that, you know. And even among the wines, there's sweet ones and dry ones. So there's a variety of flavors out there and whatever. So that's entirely up to the priest's discretion. And there are Catholic churches that do use red. And there are ones that prefer the white because it doesn't stain, just like there are Protestant churches who use white as well for the same reason. But that's entirely a practical question. It has nothing to do with doctrine.
So the wine comes from you, it's what?
Well, the wine the only wine I do sell is sacramental wine.
And
wine used for Mass.
For Mass, it's
special. Wine used for Mass must be made only from grape. There can't be anything else. We're not
so
allowed
what
to
I'm
use
saying is if they run out, can they run across the liquor store and get a grape
no.
wine?
If
they can go to my place, if, and buy wine, because mine is made from grapes.
There's a lot of wines at the liquor store.
And the
price
is right.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong with using a wine from the liquor store. There might be parishes that actually get it from the liquor store, as long as it's made properly. Hmm. And that you can guarantee that it's made. Catholics are very fussy about these things. Right? It has to be made, just like the hosts have to be made from wheat. So we can't have an absolutely gluten-free host made from rice or potato, made from rice or potato, because it's not wheat. You can have a severely low-gluten host. Again, available at Stephen Church. I also have, for Protestants only, gluten-free hosts that are made from potato starch, but we can't use those for Catholics.
The reason what?
Yeah.
Because Jesus used wheat, we must use wheat. Jesus used grape, we must use grape. We're very strict like that. It's just the way it is. That's all the questions I have.
I have a question.
Good.
After communion, locally speaking, in the last so many years, we went from kneeling down to standing.
Yeah.
What was the reasoning behind that?
The reason for that is it's from the bishop. The bishop wants us to stand as a sign of solidarity with those still going up for communion, rather than us not doing our own thing, but that we're staying together until everybody has received communion. If you turn off the camera, I can give you my answer off the record. So if you keep the camera on, I...
Is
did you?
Is that not also a directive with the rite of the new Roman Missal? No?
No. Because if it was, it would be in other jurisdictions too, which is not.
Right, which I've experienced that, yes. And I thought, okay, why aren't we all on the same page? I thought that was the whole point of this.
No.
Okay.
No, and there are local variations. The bishops might prefer one thing or another.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Are we recording or not?
You want me to?
Yes.
Turn it off?
Mm-hmm. On or off?
It's on. I don't turn it off.
Okay.
Just tell him it's off, but leave it on.
that's what I was doing.
Then I would be lying to you.
Yes.
So that explains why I'm being in a different province and we're not all doing the same thing still.
That's right.
After all of this.
That's right. Because that is, doesn't tell us to do it in the new journal. It's something the bishop is asking us to do for us. So things the bishop can make decisions that are not against the germ, but can, you know. Like, for example, you might be in a parish where after the homily, the priest wants us not to do the collection or anything yet, but just sing a song. This Sunday, we're going to sing a song, or we're going to listen to a song that's thematic with the homily or something like that. It's not forbidden, I don't think, to do that. You know, you're not going to get in trouble from the Vatican if you add a little something there. You know, that's whatever. But it's also not telling you you should do it. You know, so. Oh, good, I need questions. Yes?
Music-wise, those parishes over the years where I see that the youth are involved in the music.
Yeah.
And there's more life to the music.
Yeah.
It's not so, holy is the right word, but it's way more energized.
More contemporary.
Thank you. Is it? Where's the church's stance on that? Do they go, oh, drums gone up?
A lot of that depends on the priest.
It's the priest's.
It's
domain.
The priest. Priests can make decisions about that. And again, some priests, even if they don't personally like it, will allow it because it's not their mass. It belongs to the community, right? Mm-hmm. Some priests, well, it's more their mass. It shouldn't be, but it can be. And that's an issue of style, not substance. I think, like, the church does give general guidelines that certain styles of music, like, I would think that something like death metal, even if it had Christian words, would be very inappropriate. Mm-hmm. You know, it's too loud and brash and all that, you know. But country music, not my favorite, but it's not contrary to the faith. That's just taste, right? You know, like some like chocolate, some like vanilla. You know, I like something with a beat, and I don't really enjoy country music. But there's one or two country songs I like, right? But if I was a priest, I would not forbid a style of music just because I don't like it. There are some songs that are in the book, in the Catholic book of worship, or other Catholic hymnals. There are some songs I don't like. There's some songs I don't like their theology, you know. But again, that's, you know, part of it's my own taste, right? Do I forbid it or not? Well, I'm not the pastor anyway, so it doesn't matter, you know. But again, that can be a discussion with the priest over what you allow and what you don't allow. Yes?
We have to be careful also for choosing songs, like praise and worship songs that are not too Protestant, because we are Catholic. And there's some songs that are more Protestant than Catholic, and, you know, so we have to watch.
Yeah, but my thing is, and given I know who you talk to as well, hi, he sees the videos, what is considered too Protestant and what is not might be debatable. I might think it's not too Protestant, but a priest, you know, someone else might think it is. Who decides? You know? There are lots of songs that someone might say, oh, that's too Protestant, but I might not say it, think it's too Protestant. What objective data are we using to say whether that's Protestant or enough or Catholic enough to sing? Who draws the line?
Mm-hmm.
right? I know people who think that no praise and worship whatsoever, even if it was written by the Pope, no praise and worship should be sung during Mass at all. They tend to be very traditional and love the old Latin Mass and all that. I don't agree with that at all. I love praise and worship during Mass. And part of me would rather have a Protestant song that's at least has some Bible in it than some of the songs that are written by Catholics that the theology is really mushy. I really would rather have that. I'd rather have a song about Jesus than sing about myself. I don't want to sing about me at Mass. Some of these newer songs, I'm singing about myself. I don't want to sing about me, I want to sing about Jesus.
That was one of the criteria between Catholic and Protestants, is if the song talks about myself or a community, us. Us is more Catholic than myself.
No, but even if it's about me pointed to Jesus, yeah. But if I just want to talk about, you know, us, but it's kind of self-centered, you know, then I'd have to give you examples, which I won't do on camera, but because it's delicate and that. But I think that I'm not going to be that fussy. If it's a decent song and it's prayerful, I sing it, you know. And it wouldn't matter to me if it was Catholic or Protestant. There was a song that we sang at my old parish of Holy Redeemer that I will tell you, that to me would have been like, if you really knew what they were singing, because one of the lines was, educated by tradition, kept me far away from him. Well, that was very blatantly an anti-Catholic shot, right? The group sang, I was in this folk group that sang it, right? And every time we sang it, I wanted to scream. Don't sing that. They didn't get it. That music group didn't understand that that was a shot against Catholicism because we believe in scripture and tradition, right? And so it was like, we can't sing that song. But there's nothing wrong with Shine, Jesus, Shine, or Hosanna, or any of those songs. No. You know, so I don't know what that means, Protestant. If it's talking about Martin Luther is the only way to go, well then no, don't sing that. You know, and we sing old hymns that are Protestant.
Oh, for sure.
You know, Amazing Grace is Protestant.
Yeah.
Yes.
Hello. You know, so where do we draw the line? You know, it's not that it's Protestant or not. You know, some of the best writers of Christian music are Protestant. There, it's on the record. Right? Don't worry about that. You know? Yes?
On a different topic than the topic we were
talking
about earlier, about standing up. I feel bad a lot of times when I go to funerals and we do our own thing of standing up and everybody else is sitting down. And like for one funeral that I wasn't too long ago, one of our parishioners' husband died and she's right in the front. She's standing up, everybody else is sitting down. Man, I feel bad for her. Yeah. You know, and I see that all the time at funerals. Because the funerals, you admit it, that not everybody's Catholic there.
No, like when I do a baptism and I say, the Lord be with you, and everyone else says, and also with you. I know they haven't been to Mass in 4 years. You know? So it's a bit
awkward. Parish.
Yeah.
That's what he does that.
It's a bit awkward, yeah.
But that's the wrongness of the people going to the church, whether they're not Catholic or not, because if you go to a funeral, you should be following what the people do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, when we go to a church, another church, you don't know what they're going to do. Do they sit down? Do they stand up? Do
no.
they,
that's
you
right.
know? You know?
If you're visiting another denomination
yeah.
for a funeral, that's why it's never sit in the front, ever. When you're visiting another diocese, even if it's Catholic,
mm-hmm.
never be the first person to go to communion, never do any of that stuff if you're going to another Catholic church. Don't sit in the front if you're visiting, you're going to a Lutheran funeral and you've never been to a Lutheran church before. Sit in the middle, you know, so you know what to do when everyone else is doing. If you go to a synagogue or a mosque or wherever you're going, sit in the middle. So you can at least follow people, you know, so you know what. Otherwise, you you know, if I'm in another diocese and they do something else, you know, it's like, okay, I better watch, you know. And I'm like that. I will do what everyone else is doing. Whether I like it or don't like it, whether it's my thing or not, I will do what everyone else is doing most of the time.
But even if it is our own parish, we can still sit down because not, most of the people are not standing like we used. It's not really disrespectful of the bishops, right?
Well, I think when I go to church and I, and because the bishop has brought this forward that we should all stand until the Eucharist is put in the sacristy, I think us, as we all do it, it's a community thing. So if the community is standing, I think we should all stand. And if you look around, and I would say 70% of us are standing, I think we should all stand. It really bugs me when I turn. It does. It bugs me. It bugs me when I turn and I see someone on their knees praying. Well, you know what? We would all like to do that too. I'm sure there's lots of us in the church that would like to take that extra time to prayer, to say hello to Jesus. But you know what I mean? You could do that standing up. And I'm thinking, are you not part of the community here? We're all standing. You know what I mean? So that's what my mind is thinking in church. And I shouldn't think that way, but I do. Yeah. It bugs me.
It's a sign of unity.
Yeah.
Yeah, I understand that. And even though that part of that, that if I was off camera, I would answer more fully, my own personal opinion on that. But if I were the bishop, it would no longer be the rule. I'll tell you that.
So when is the proper time to kneel after the Eucharist? Is it when the last person has received the Eucharist?
You know, I don't know, because I've seen it done differently in different parishes.
Or is it when it's the Eucharist is returned back to the tabernacle?
I seem to see that people tend to... The thing is that in some parishes they just sit.
Yeah.
I've been in some parishes where they actually will kneel for a little while, which I thought was a good compromise, that if everybody knelt for a little while... that at least it retained that older custom as well, you know, the kind of a compromise. We'll do both. We'll all stand until everyone's ready to kneel, and then we kneel together. But a lot of them just go from standing to just sitting.
Yeah.
There's no time of interior prayer. Okay. You had a question first.
Yeah, I tried your plan. I was in Germany about 30 years ago, and I went to a Catholic church. And so I walked in, I said, I'm going to be smart, I'm going to sit in the middle. And I sat in the middle, and I started looking around. Everybody was looking at me, I said, there's something wrong here. And then I realized halfway through Mass that one side was for the females, and the other side was for the males. It was just before communion that I realized that. But you know what? I got up, I'm a Canadian, and I went to communion with the ladies.
The ladies.
Ladies first.
But you walked funny, didn't you?
You sure you weren't in a Hutterite church?
Small community.
That's hilarious.
I would have noticed. And all the men were outside till the church bells ring, and then the ladies are all inside, and they all come in and sit on the right.
I couldn't
believe it.
Mm-hmm.
That's funny. We did that, but we went in church like that.
Okay, I'm going to go there, and then I'm going to go there.
I don't know if it's in the leaflet that we have in all of our pews in our parish, or whether it's in that Celebrate and Song book that was produced at the time of the New Roman Missal release.
Mm-hmm.
But one of those gives instruction that we all remain standing until the last person has received communion,
right,
which would be the communion, and then those would be those ministers of song.
Right.
Right? They're the last to receive.
Right.
And yet, yes, in our parish, somehow we're still clinging to that tradition of that, well, we can't afford to kneel down, sit down, whatever, till, you know, the Blessed Sacrament is back in the tabernacle. So, what to do?
It's not up to me to answer that question. Yeah, that's again the custom, whatever. Yeah.
Even that is a disconnect within our own parish.
Yeah.
Of what is recent instruction of how it should be happening, so that we're more uniform across by the, you know, at least in accord with the Canadian Conference of Catholic Bishops, at least some of the things that we'd like to see, but we're still in our own.
I know.
In our old ways. Yeah.
At the same time, though, you're never going to have 100% uniformity.
That's
there are
that's
people with medical conditions that can't
sit
for long
never,
periods of time.
But that's
or people
always
have
been
meal.
For
yeah.
a thousand, 2,000 years.
Yeah.
We've never done that.
A
lot of
people like tradition, too.
No. Yeah.
Is it no longer not a custom, but like to put our hands this way during the Our Father?
Yeah.
Some people do, some people don't. I know there was a little writing in one of our bulletin, but is that, again, just a preference, or is that a rule?
Well, I read something online a couple of weeks ago, and this was someone who was pretty strict. And, of course, the rubrics, the word rubric coming from the Latin word for red, because in the missal, in the book the priest has, all the instructions are in red, and then what he says out loud is in black. So they always talk about, you know, do the red and say the black.
Right.
Say the black, don't make up your own words, you know. But I'm, because the rubrics say the priest does this,
right.
Mm-hmm. They interpret it as everyone else is forbidden to do it.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm a charismatic, all right? I'm going to stick my hands up whenever I want. You know what I mean? We're not forbidden to do this. And a liturgical principle is, what is this? The Orans position is when you're praying, you pray like this, right? So the parts of the Mass where the priest is praying alone, only the priest is doing this. The Our Father, who's praying the Our Father? Just the presider? The entire congregation. There are paintings from the early church in the catacombs, and they're not all priests, it's the whole congregation of 10 people or whatever was in the picture. They all have their hands in the Orans position. Again, not having a PhD in liturgy or even a master's or even a bachelor's degree in liturgy. Okay, but just being a regular Catholic, there is, even if I wasn't a deacon, I would pray the Our Father like this. You know? If I wasn't too shy, I'd pray the Our Father like that. You know, a little charismatic or whatever. It's not forbidden. I figure if Rome doesn't want us to do it, it would say, you will not do that. There are a lot of things in the book that says you can't do thus and so. Right? So no, it's very common all over the church to go like this, like the Catholic world, to pray like this at the Our Father. Again, if the priest prefers that you don't, well, be nice and follow his, you know, be faithful to what the local authority wants. But I don't think there's anything that forbids us from doing it. Yes.
From what I understood, we're welcome to pray that way for the Our Father, but at the end of the Our Father, we should be putting our hands down, because the next is the priest prayer, where it says, deliver us, Lord, from every evil.
Yeah. So
we should not have our hands.
No, they might not. But
part.
Again, I'm not going to be overly legalistic about it if they are holding hands.
Okay.
I'm not that legalistic. You know,
got
I'm kind of a progressive conservative, you know. Ha ha ha. Anyway, I want to move forward, and I don't want to be too hard, but practically speaking, like I'll do that at Mass, where Our Father, and deliver us, Lord, from every evil, and I'll bring my hands like this, right? And the priest does that little prayer, and then for thine is the kingdom, they pop out again, you know? Because again, we're saying, we're praying again, for the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. So I'm saying it again. Because I used to watch at a concelebrated Mass, where there's like 40 priests around the altar. Okay, all the priests can celebrate, and they all go like that. Then the presider does that little prayer. They all make their hands go like this. And then for thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, their hands go back out again, because they're praying again. So I'm like, okay, well, that's more the rule, right? You go like this when you're not praying the prayer, and if just the presider is going, then when you're back to praying again, you go back to the Orans position.
Right.
I'm not going to kill anybody if there's a family of five still holding hands all through the thing, because they don't want to let go and join again. So just
practice.
Stay like that. What does it kill?
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. You know, we get all huffy and puffy about there's enough strictness in Catholicism without micromanaging everybody.
She's holding.
Okay. And again, I'm teaching from my point of view. Someone else can give you a totally opposite answer, but I'm right.
Okay.
Because I think I try to find a moderate balance between the extremes of being overly strict or overly loose, right? And so I think that this is an ancient way of praying. And if we're praying the prayer, well, like this. If the priest, like, he goes, let us pray, and then he does the opening prayer like this, right? Or he does the consecration, okay? Nobody else, you know, like, for example, again, during a concelebrated mass, okay, for the consecration, all the other priests stretch their hands out. Why? Because they're praying it with him. Okay. I'm a deacon. You know what I'm doing? I'm kneeling. I don't pray that prayer with the priest. I'm not a priest. You don't pray that prayer. I mean, in your heart, you follow, but you're not concelebrating, you're not consecrating the host with him. So your gesture isn't like that because you're not sharing in that action. The Our Father is different. We are all praying it together. Therefore, it's okay in my book to do that. Just because the line doesn't say, and all the priests should do it. You know, the Pope made a new rule, right, about washing the feet. Just 2 weeks ago. He finally made it official. Anybody. And it should be representative of the people, right? Again, you'll have the people that don't like it because it's never, you know, it's new, it's whatever. But we have been doing it on a practical level for 40 years, right? The Pope's been doing it since he became Pope. See, the only picky part I would do is when Francis became Pope, and if I knew that he did that as bishop, I'd say, before you do it as Pope, change the rule first, then do it. That would be my only fussy part, was change the rule so that you're obeying your own rule. But now, having been Pope for 3 years, he's finally changed the rule. So, but luckily he can do that, you know. But for me, my reaction when the rule was changed was great. This is awesome. Because we're all doing this anyway.
What change?
So what's the rule?
The washing of the feet.
That anybody can.
That rather than have just only men have their feet washed. Because that's what the rules were.
Yeah.
Up until the Pope changed it 2 weeks ago, the rules were only men could have their feet washed. But for 30 years, 90% of our parishes in North America have been washing anybody's feet. Okay? Every priest was breaking the rule, including Bishop Bergoglio when he was in Buenos Aires was breaking the rule. Okay? Well, now, and even as Pope, for the last 3 years, he was breaking the rule. Right? But everybody ignored the rule except the ones that knew the rule and they were upset about it. I knew the rule, but I didn't care, you know, because it's a small thing. And the thing is, the washing of the feet has nothing to do with the people whose feet are being washed, with them representing priests. Even though Jesus washed the 12 apostles, he was showing them what they should do outside of Mass. Okay? There's a difference between the priesthood and this action. This action is meant to wash the feet of everybody, right? And so therefore, it's meant to symbolize. But we've been doing it in our parishes for 40, 50 years. As long as I can remember, the crowd was always mixed. Unless I had a very traditional priest who only chose 12 men or 12 boys or whatever, 12 guys. To represent the 12 apostles. Why did I get on that? I don't know.
Anyway. While you're on that topic, I believe I've once experienced that it was the washing of the hands, not the washing of the feet. What dost thou sayest?
Well, the liturgy says washing of the feet.
Yeah, true.
So, I've heard of people doing it on retreat. Like
no,
on Holy Thursday?
During
Holy
Thursday
liturgy?
Yeah.
Okay. It's a variation. I don't know. You know, when I'm on camera, I don't like it. Yeah.
It's
thank you.
Just deviates from the symbolism
of washing the feet. But again, I don't know if there's a reason for doing that.
Like couldn't bend over to...
You know,
know.
Was it Mass with amputees or what was it? You know?
I have no idea.
No, women aren't supposed to be showing their feet.
I'm not judging the...
Maybe.
They're supposed to have the gowns that go right to the floor, and they shouldn't be letting men...
Not that strict.
They shouldn't be letting men see their feet.
Very good.
Now it's knees.
Those were the days. Yeah.